Hi, everyone, and welcome. Thanks for joining us for Miami Inno's State of Innovation panel centered around the consumer of the future. I'm Ashley Portero. I'm a senior reporter at Miami Inno and the South Florida Business Journal, where I cover technology. So any moment, we'll have our panelists turn on their cameras and join us. Hi, everyone. Thank you. Let's see. All right. We have everyone. Thank you. Thank you. So just so you know, Miami Inno is part of American Inno. We are a growing network of websites with a presence in more than 40 markets right now. We focus on covering and connecting local startups and innovation ecosystems. You can check out my coverage at miamiinno.com. And while you're there, you can also sign up for The Beat. That's our newsletter that goes out every Tuesday and Thursday. And before we get started, I want to take a moment to thank our presenting sponsor, Accenture, for helping us put this event together today. I'd also like to thank our founding partners, Writer, Comcast Business, and OmniPublic. So today we are going to be speaking with experts and founders about the consumer of the future. We are going to talk about changes to the retail industry and consumer behavior and hear about how businesses have been staying adaptive this whole time. As a reminder to our audience, you are on mute right now. If you have any questions for our panel, just drop those into the questions box you see below. We'll get to those questions sometime during our conversation or when we wrap up the panel. So let's get started. Today joining us, we have John Gruber, COO of ShipMonk, Dan Baldor, Managing Director of Accenture, and Alvaro de Jesus, co-founder of Pivot Market. We're going to start by getting a quick introduction to all of our panelists. John, let's start with you. Can you take a moment to tell us about ShipMonk and your role at the company?
Yes, thank you, Ashley. ShipMonk provides fulfillment third-party logistics services for small and medium-sized businesses to various channels, whether they're direct consumer, wholesale, or retail. It's a newer company that's been existed for about 6 years. I've joined with them approximately 3 years ago. Excuse me, 6 months ago. And what we focus on is really leveling the logistical playing field with larger brands. So I've spent the last 20 years of my career in third-party logistics, working with some of the largest brands in the world. And at ShipMonk, what we're doing is essentially bringing a model to forward that will allow for many small and medium-sized businesses to build critical mass to enable the same type of logistical execution and costs that some of the largest companies in the world can achieve. So it's a very exciting space to be in, particularly with the evolution of boutique online stores in the last 5 or so years.
Great, thanks, John. And we're excited to have you join us today. Let's move on to Alvaro. Can you give us a quick introduction to Pivot Market?
Absolutely. Thank you, Ashley. So Pivot Market is a retailing platform connecting independent brands and independent boutiques under a new commerce paradigm called retail as a service, where as opposed to wholesaling, where stores are buying products from brands, we essentially allow brands to find retailers that are willing to run spaces inside their own stores as if it were the brand's very own brick and mortar store. So this ties very well to what we just heard from ShipMonk, because we are actually also in that business of leveling the playing field for smaller brands that want to have an omnichannel strategy. And this allows for that because by partnering with the stores, they're able to implement sort of a Warby Parker strategy without having to build out these new brick and mortar locations.
Very cool, thank you. And Dan, can you give us an introduction to Accenture?
Sure, Ashley. Thank you. And thanks for having me today. Hi, everyone. Dan Baldor. I'm a senior managing director for Accenture, and I'm the Accenture office managing director for the South Florida office based in Miami. Accenture is a global professional services company with experience and specialized skills and across more than 40 industries, including the retail sector, which we're going to talk about today. We offer strategy and consulting, interactive, we're the largest digital agency in the world, technology and operations services, all powered by the world's largest network of advanced technology and intelligent operations centers. We work with 91 out of the Fortune 100 companies and 3/4 of the Fortune 500 companies in the world. And I'm glad to be here today. So thanks for having me.
Thank you. All right. So let's jump into the panel. And we are going to start with everybody's favorite topic, COVID. I'm sure you've probably heard, you know, had your fill talking about this over the past year, but we're going to get to it. I want to start by reflecting on the ways that the COVID pandemic impacted retail. I'm wondering, how would you say the pandemic affected the industry and more specifically your business? Alvaro, let's start with you.
Well, in my case, it was pretty direct. We've been independent retailers here in Miami for the past 7 years. So we had to close down our stores for 6 months. And we had to really reinvent ourselves. So previously, we were running traditional brick and mortar stores, doing wholesaling. Back in 2019, we transitioned into this retail as a service approach where we invited the brands that we were collaborating with or that we were selling in our store to pay us a fee, and that we would run those spaces as if it were their own brick and mortar store. We were doing that successfully. And when COVID came, we understood that at the very beginning, there was probably a lot of hype about just going online, boutiques are going to disappear. Nobody's ever going to touch or go into a physical retailer. But we took a gamble and said, you know, when this is over, people are going to come back to the stores. So we started developing this SaaS-enabled marketplace where we are inviting other stores and other brands to collaborate in this new way of commerce. So I think that reinventing, it's the common thread among all of the retailers and e-commerce brands out there.
And what about today? I'm wondering, have you made any changes that you expect will be permanent moving forward?
Yeah, so I think that as e-commerce has become more central to brand strategies, it makes a lot of sense for any other activity that brands are engaging with, meaning the physical retailing, that those activities support their online strategies. So namely an omnichannel strategy where you're able to, in the physical stores, you're not only seeing those physical stores as a point of sale, but also how do you capture demand? How do you capture demand generation, but also capture so that you can offer that omnichannel feel to the consumer where they're able to interact with products in the physical world and probably buy them online. So making that connection has been at the center of our strategy.
Got it. And John, same question to you. How would you say the pandemic affected ShipMonk's operations?
Yeah, so I think it affected ShipMonk and retailers in different ways, depending on where they're the channels that we're serving. For ShipMonk, because majority of our merchants that we work with are digital, you know, first, it was an incredible boon for business, where we saw, you know, year over year sales for our clients increase by hundreds, if not 200-300%. And that was really true, I would say, the 2020 trend. So there's a lot of ramping up of production and products in, and a lot of pent-up demand, because online was really the only place in which you were able to buy products. And we had a lot of consumers sitting at home on their phones who were making, you know, gratification buys. Shifting forward in 2021, I think what we've seen is that pent-up desire to go and socialize has allowed that pendulum to swing the other direction to where in-store retail is now booming. But that's also being held back by lack of product and inventory we're reading about with the ports congestion. So it's an interesting environment where demand is extremely high now for storefronts and selection of inventory is very low. So consumers are almost forced to buy what's available versus the selection that could be available because of the the pent-up demand. So it's been very interesting because you've seen it go from where you've had this incredible demand for online needs. And then as that waned, as people started wanting to get out and socialize, then digital forward brands have also had to rethink their models and try to figure out how to get into the other channels where they were simply full all in to online direct consumer in 2020. So,
and jumping off of that, you know, as you know, ShipMonk, I know you guys, I think, primarily work with digital brands. So how would you say businesses are responding to that shift?
The shift back to retail?
Yes.
Yeah. Partnering with retailers that have either and wholesalers, companies that they have their branded storefronts and wholesaling products into them to get better shelf presence has been a big shift. We've also seen, you know, part of what's happened at the same time that COVID's happened is there's also been some changes to how online advertising is working with some of the opt-in, opt-out policies. So the cost of acquiring customers is going up. That's forcing, you know, less ad spending online, and they're reshifting those dollars to try to create retail partnerships. So it's very interesting to see this evolve.
Got it. And so John was just talking a little bit about how, you know, some consumer changes over the past year. Dan, can you tell me a little bit about that on from Accenture's point of view? Have you noticed any major changes over the course of the COVID pandemic?
Sure, sure. And let me say, I agree with John and Alvaro's comments. We see a lot of the same things. A couple of things. So number one, we see five trends really. And it's important to say that these trends existed, I think, before COVID. What happened is that COVID accelerated these trends, really. The first of these trends is, you know, moving more to digital. You know, certainly the pandemic has accelerated key retail trends that were already underway, igniting this new surge for digital customers. And there are tremendous opportunities for retailers to connect with today digitally focused customers and rethinking how they engage with these new digital customers, because more and more of customers are becoming digital customers online. Retailers need to adapt their ways of working to deliver personalized interactions with these digital customers and leading really to longer lasting relationships, more loyalty programs. So I think that's number one, the move to digital. The second one is around thinking locally and acting locally. In other words, as retail supply chains become more complex, we're seeing this, the strategies to shift from a more global view of the supply chain to a more local view of the supply chain to be able to serve customers better and to be able to control the costs associated with that supply chain. Local omni-channel fulfillment is how retailers are differentiating themselves versus global, larger retail companies. And getting those results means constantly resetting those strategies across insights, networks, inventory, delivery systems, et cetera. So the pressure really is on for retail fulfillment to no longer to be in the background, but for customers to also have high expectations. I think a third trend that we're seeing, and it's again moving faster and faster as a result of COVID, is customers want to buy from retailers that have a sustainable mindset. Sustainability is important, making sure that the products that they're selling and customers are buying from them are sourced in the right way, that there's transparency in the supply chain, and there's surety in the supply chain as well. The fourth, I think, major trend that we're seeing is that we need to reimagine the workforce. A retail workforce can adapt to constant change at speeds that it's never been more critical. To meet those evolving expectations of customers and employees, we think retailers need to be more adaptive to the workforce, being more digital, data fluent, and diverse. And really few retailers have invested in these new skills, right? Workers want to be skilled up in new ways and new ways of working. So it's really up to the retailer to think through how are they going to upskill the workforce of the future. And then lastly, I think the last trend really is around data. And I think retailers are noticing that they've got a lot of data, they just don't know what to do with it. And they really, those that are advancing and getting ahead are treating data as a strategic asset. So retailers who continually and responsibly reset the business will thrive in this world because things are changing so fast. And many retailers are data rich, like we mentioned, but insights are poor. So those that get a handle of that data and be able to draw insights from that data are capturing more of the market share and retaining those clients and those customers for longer periods of time.
Got it. Thank you. And you know, one of the points that Dan mentioned was that the pandemic forced some retailers to rethink their digital strategies. I'm curious, can any of you tell me about did ShipMonk or Pivot Market, did you have to rethink your digital strategy and how did you do that?
I can jump in. I mean, what we've been working with is really working with our brands and merchants to just rethink how they can get into other channels, but also acquire more customers. So one of the things that we're able to do is we can talk to our customers who are succeeding in the times in which, as we've seen, there's been resurgence back to retail about what's winning for them. Now they're acquiring more customers online. So while we don't share anything that's, you know, confidential, we share a lot of good information with our clients in terms of what we think is the right way to approach things. And we're also offering more services that we haven't provided in the past to enable brands to enter wholesale markets and much more easier. There's a lot of requirements when you work with large retailers. They have retail routing guides and certain restrictions. And if you aren't able to follow those guidelines, it can become very expensive. So, you know, it's very complicated to figure out on your own, if not impossible. It takes years of experience and documentation. So we're helping our clients navigate the environment those ways.
Thank you. And Alvaro, we have a question for you from one of our viewers. They're wondering, can you give an example of one of your retail partnerships or omnichannel partnerships?
Sure. So in terms of boutiques, we've seen not only our own store located here in Miami, but others across the US that have shifted their model basically, and this ties very neatly to what Dan was just mentioning about data. I would argue that they're not only rich in data, but they're also rich in terms of creating loyalty with consumers. It still remains the most important touch point. And what our whole mission with Pivot is to enable those boutique owners to capture some of that value by partnering with the brands in a more fluent way in terms of data sharing. So we're sort of shifting the model by placing the consumer at the center. And that means that collaboration between the brand and the store revolves around that. And whenever there's a sale, whenever there's an engagement with a product in the store or there's a sale, then the brand gets a piece of that information and they can have better visibility in terms of not only their sales, but their inventory levels down to their customer data and some engagement metrics so that they can have a better understanding and use that data to power their online presence. And for the side of the brands, also as John was actually mentioning the opt-in and opt-out and customer acquisition going up in social media, well, it happens that stores are a great tool for customer acquisition, but there isn't a great way for independent boutiques, at least, so more sophisticated retailers might have some of this in place, but for independent stores to actually fulfill that role of customer acquisition. So those are the two things that we are enabling both the brand and the store to get out of that physical location.
I'm wondering, are there any particular data points that you look at that are the most valuable, or would you say lead to the most, you know, insight for some of these brands?
Yes. So when you walk into a Pivot store, the focus is on experience. So when we're talking about experience and consumers having all the options that they do have right now online, they don't want to be sold to. They want to have an experience, they want to know about the product, and they know that they have the choices to either buy in the store, perhaps place the order there, then get the fulfillment from a different warehouse, or just buy online. What's important is the level of engagement that we are. So think of it this way. I think that in the future, retailers will start operating not only as points of sales, but much like a Facebook or an Instagram does, where they're billboards, where people interact with their products. And the challenge is to capture that engagement metrics so that brands have better visibility of what's happening inside the stores.
Got it, thank you. I'm going to move on a little bit. I believe earlier that John was talking about, he mentioned how COVID, you know, resulted in a boost, you know, in demand. And in general, there was a boost in consumer spending during the pandemic. I'm wondering, John, can you tell me how can ShipMonk maintain that sort of demand moving forward?
Yeah, I mean, I think the really it's connecting with the consumers and your customer base and creating a personal relationship with them. I think that is what we're seeing is that consumers are particularly for products that are non-commoditized. So what I mean by that is, you know, something, let me step back, right? The Amazons, the Walmarts and so forth, right? Commoditized goods, lowest cost wins. Brands will be successful when they create products that are unique, that add value, that when they can connect their customers and that there's loyalty to them. So I think that's the easier said than done problem. But I mean, that's really what we need to all be after is that creating products and brand loyalty that justifies you know, coming back versus being one of multiples. I think that is really the problem to solve when it comes to keeping demand coming in.
Got it. And Dan, can you give me your thoughts on this? What do you think? Like, how can retailers try to keep up this level of demand moving forward?
Well, let's talk about the time of year that we're in right now. So we're in the holiday period. And so recently, just a few weeks ago, we released a survey, a survey where we offered some insights into consumer buying patterns during the holiday period, pretty much providing an indication of the retail performance expectations for both in-store and online transactions. And there were a few key insights from that study that we just released. So number one, it's really interesting. In-store shopping has returned and mainly not with the group that you would think. It's mostly with what we call, I guess, Generation Z consumers. So despite the ongoing pandemic, the comfort with in-store shopping is actually returning. And with these younger groups, they want to go into the store to get an experience like my colleagues were just talking about. They want a personalized experience. They're obviously very digitally savvy and they're able to buy online and they can if they want to. But these younger generations are going into the store because they're looking for that more personal experience for the product that they want to buy. Interestingly enough, the older generations, the baby boomers or even some Gen Xers, are actually increasing their online shopping.
The survey indicate why?
Well, you could argue it's for COVID, for fear of you know, being in spaces where maybe they don't feel necessarily safe or whatever the case may be. But you would think the baby boomers who, you know, grew up in being in shopping in store would be more comfortable with in store. They're actually increasing their rate of buying online, which is pretty amazing. So you can see that trend growing and growing and how that's going to sustainably just continue to grow in terms of the demand. I think the second thing that we're seeing, which is really interesting, is that the things that people are buying during this time is not necessarily, I mean, sure, the tangible things that you buy one another, but actually consumers are prioritizing time and money on experiences. So they're redirecting their spend from physical gifts to experiences and services, which is a really interesting shift over the holidays. So I can see that growing over time as well, where the focus is on having an excellent experience. Again, buying experience, but also what you're buying for yourself, the experience itself, not just a physical item. And then another really key interesting trend is that in the past we saw you know, Black Friday deals or, you know, whatever the case may be. But if you're noticing some of the advertising you're seeing online and some of the things that we're getting you know, through TV or print or radio or whatever, it's the season of Black Friday, meaning you've now elongated the buying period where you can get these really great deals. And it's to try to shift consumer buying patterns to be able to then buy earlier, take, you know, try to address some of the supply chain issues that we're facing, and get folks to kind of stretch out their buying time period, so to speak, so that we can at least ease the pressure on the overall supply chain that we're feeling right now. And I think that kind of behavior will lead beyond the holidays. You'll start to see, you know, longer buying patterns in the future. And I think that's going to help in terms of keeping up and building up that demand that we just talked about.
Got it. And so Dan was just mentioning, you know, how retailers are seeing younger people, Gen Z age people returning to stores to shop. Alvaro, I'm wondering, what are you seeing with Pivot Market? Are you seeing people coming back to stores? Are you noticing any kind of demographics that are returning?
Yes. So in the US, for sure, we're back from the pandemic. So I think that Dan just nailed it. It's all about the experience, and that this new generation, the Gen Z, it's all about authenticity. And given our customers and the retailers, you know, it's mostly small boutiques operated by their owners. There's no, you know, it's as authentic as it can get. So it's, these store owners are there for a purpose. They have, they could be doing anything else, but they run their stores because there's something in their community. There's some need in their community that they're very much tied into that they want to provide, that they want to meet. So that authenticity that stems from that owner just greeting their customers and having a great just human interaction, it doesn't need to be very much complicated than that. I think it's what's attracting Gen Z so much to this, you know, corner boutique.
And I'm wondering, does that surprise you, or does that surprise anyone on the panel because of sort of the cliche that Gen Z just like wants to be in their room on the phone all the time?
It surprises me a little bit, but again, Gen Z has all these options. They can buy online and they do it really well. But I think the challenge for buying online will be, how do you personalize that? How do you make it a better experience so that you can grow that channel even greater, so to speak? If you commoditize that experience where it just becomes just a regular transaction, I think you'll see savvy consumers move away from those types of online transactions and focus to the companies that are operating online that are making it a better, as Alvaro just mentioned, just a better experience overall. So it is surprising, but at the same time, this trend is going to continue to grow.
Got it. And just moving on a little bit. So I was reading that during COVID, e-commerce experienced something like 10 years of growth in less than a year. John, I was wondering, how has this boom affected the way you think about ShipMonk and consumer behavior?
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the probably most interesting things that's happened is that this people have become aware that opening up store and selling products online is easier than ever. And literally anyone can start with, you know, having a product idea created, having a, whether it's Kickstarter or some other method, raise capital, have the product manufactured, sent out, and really start their own business. So I think the competitive landscape, the barrier of entry to really open up your own online storefront is the lowest it's ever been. It won't get lower. And then with companies like ShipMonk and others who can provide, you know, all the logistical services to get the products to the consumer's hands, it's really turning into what can be a no-touch environment. From a product standpoint. So I think that is really some of the acceleration. The other thing I would comment on is that we're rethinking how we're moving goods to consumers in interesting ways. As much as the demand's been growing, the final mile delivery network, that's another to term for the UPSs and FedExes, the world, or DHLs, that's way behind in terms of capacity for what's needed. So you're seeing a lot of investment in new companies figuring out, how do we get packages to consumers even faster? Amazon has set the kind of trend of two-day delivery, but they're able to do that because of their scale. And you know, I think the next evolution is going to be when we infrastructure-wise, we build out a network that will enable even faster delivery at the lowest cost possible to consumers. So,
could you give us some examples of what that could entail?
Yeah, so most recently, there's a couple companies entering the market, which are going to be creating a new national parcel network carrier. So the names that people know are UPS, FedEx, and possibly DHL. Of course, you have the U.S. Postal Service, but recently, two companies merged. One was called LaserShip, who services the East Coast, and another's called OnTrack, services the West Coast. And in the next few years with that merger, these were regional delivery companies who the average consumer doesn't know of, but if you order from any online company, you're getting packages from these companies today, just not as well branded. And as they enter that, as those two companies merge and add more competition, it's gonna help bring price points down, you know, cost of delivery down, more competition in the market, which is really needed because it's really a duopoly today between two companies, UPS and FedEx, and they set the market. And coincidentally, every single year they do rate increases on their packages. And also coincidentally, their rate increases are within 0.1% of each other. So it's competition that's coming will bring a lot of more cost competitiveness to actually doing the delivery of the goods to consumers.
Got it, thank you. And kind of related, one of the big challenges this year, in addition to, you know, inflation, has been disrupted supply chains and labor shortages. I'm wondering, have any of you, ShipMonk, Accenture, Pivot Market, have you experienced any challenges resulting from supply chain shortages? And if so, what were those challenges?
Yeah, I'll jump in first. Labor is paramount to our success, right? Although we deploy significant automation to make the jobs for our teammates easier, much of our work still requires humans to do the activities of picking and packing orders. And it's a fierce market. I mean, we've increased our wages significantly to keep up with inflation pressures. And particularly now, there's a fight for talent. And as everyone's getting ready for peak season. So I think we're working through some temporary, I mean, we've seen the reporting from Wall Street Journals and others, we're in near record wage inflation periods. I think that's temporary as we get the easy money under control. But it's really, I think the market's changed. What we're finding is that we just need to be much more flexible with people, different shift schedules, different hours, same day pay. That's a very competitive market out there. And then briefly comment on the supply chain delays. We're seeing product coming in significantly late. And also we've seen some of our customers simply throw their hands up because of the increased cost of containers moving them from China to the US to where in some cases, the cost to actually transport the goods is more than the actual value of goods, which can do that. So there's some people who just parked it on the sideline who said, hey, we're gonna wait till these inflationary pressures for commodities and transportation ease, and then they're gonna come back to the market. So the last thing I would just say is if anyone's done, you know, to go get Halloween decorations or Christmas decorations, I promise you the supply is gonna be extremely small. I mean, there's just too many containers in the water that should have been here months ago. So stock up early if you need stuff because the shelves will be empty soon.
And Alvaro, can you talk about that? Have you experienced any challenges tied to some of these supply chain issues?
Yes, absolutely. Not only supply chain, but also as you mentioned, the workforce. We've seen mostly impacted by that. Our customer base, you know, being small retailers where it's a store owner plus two sales associates or workers, it's really prompted us to give them more tools to automate some of their processes so that they can focus on more valuable activities. And yes, I think that that's a challenge. And also for us internally, it's been also about dealing with more visibility across all of your spendings, making sure that also in an inflationary world, just making sure that there's a lot of visibility in terms of every dollar spent, be it marketing, operations, and so forth.
Got it. And going back, both of you were just mentioning some challenges that have come with labor. And that's, you know, been an issue across retail, hospitality, several industries at this point. I was wondering, Dan, can you talk a little bit about how does retail need to think about the way it hires or operates? How does the industry need to rethink this moving forward?
Yeah, the challenge that both my colleagues were mentioning are real in terms of the increased wages, but also the worker itself is demanding more from their employer. They're demanding flexible work hours. They're demanding upskilling. So not to do necessarily, you know, repeatable rote type work, but yet do things that are much more valuable in terms of increasing the value to the end customer. So we need to be very creative in how we address these problems. We need to be to listen to the potential employee. We need to rethink about how to reskill, and we need to be flexible in the way that we actually hire and put these workers to help in terms of solving some of the issues in what we call ultimately this gig economy. So there's we've got to be creative in the way that we actually address some of these labor issues.
And when you're talking about, you know, some of the issues with the gig economy, so what can employers do to, I guess, reduce some of those concerns for workers so they want to come back?
Well, there's a number of things. We can try to leverage other companies, even outsource some of this work necessarily to companies that work generally in this gig type of economy. And we could look at part-time hiring as well, and look to be able to satisfy the worker's desire to be able to work either certain hours during the day, or try to, you know, extend the workday to include additional what we would call offline hours, et cetera. There's just a number of ways that we can try to actually address some of these things from the worker's perspective, satisfy their requirements, and yet still get the help that we need to be able to move our product within the supply chain.
Got it. And I'm wondering, John, can you talk about how you're approaching this at ShipMonk? Has the labor shortage affected the company? And what are some tactics you can take to bring people back?
Yeah, it has. And that we've raised wages in all of our fulfillment centers pretty significantly over the past year now. We've been able to do that and keep the cost for our merchants same. So we recognize that this is that everyone's under a lot of pressure. So we've absorbed those costs, but it's definitely something that is impacting us. And but what we're doing to combat the variable labor availability issues is something as Dan mentioned earlier, is that we're being much more creative in terms of, I think there's two groups, right? We have the teammates who work inside the fulfillment centers, hands-on work, and we have a lot of people who can do virtual work. So in terms of the hands-on teams, being very flexible with hours in terms of shifts, paying more for undesired shifts. Recently, we've implemented a partnering with a company, third-party company, who's allowing people to take their pay on the same day to a certain percentage. And we're doing things like that to be more attractive in terms of, obviously the environment too. We have some fun warehouses, I would say, in terms of how it's how you interact with people. We've invested a lot of technology to make jobs easier, a lot of robotics and autonomous robots that are running around with our teammates. So trying to create a work environment which is competitive and better than the average, I think, is key, and then flexibility in terms of hours, pay, and access to pay are some of the things. In terms of the staff, our account managers, customer service, app and such engineers, all the people really keep our merchants informed of what's going on. We've implemented a very flexible work schedule, and we've been enabled by technology so that people can really work from anywhere. So we hire great people. We expect a lot of them, but we allow them to, you know, do their jobs at the times in which it makes sense for them. So those are some of the ways in which we're combating, you know, the labor shortages right now.
And I think this this was kind of addressed before, I think, by more than one panelist, but I think a few of you have mentioned how, especially with some younger consumers, environmental and social responsibility is becoming more of a concern. More people are researching companies to get an idea of, you know, where they stand or how they're, you know, reducing their carbon impact, things like that. With that in mind, how, you know, what are you doing to try to make your business more environmentally or socially responsible, or just to communicate that to customers? And can we start with Pivot Market?
Absolutely. So the genesis of Pivot Market really revolves around sustainability. We created the first sustainable department store here in the city of Miami. So we create all of our brands around sustainability across different dimensions, type of materials, the sourcing, ethical sourcing. So just all across, it's from the beginning, we've been really focused on sustainability because not only do we believe in it, but consumers, well, actually we started 7 years ago when it wasn't that popular. We sort of created the first sustainable boutique in Miami as well back then. So it became a hub for these sustainable brands that wanted a place that met their values and that it made sense for them to be there. And as we transition to a more of a tech platform, connecting brands and stores, not only do we extend those values to our retailers and our brands, but also the way that we're shifting the model by giving more visibility to the brands in terms of their inventory. It also reinforces that sustainability aspect. So it means that by having more information, they're able to better, plan their production. There's less waste because on the wholesale model, basically you're selling to these boutiques all over the country, and you don't have any idea of what's being sold, if there's any broken collections in store A versus on store B, where you can actually do some crossing of merchandise to have a better presence on the shelves. So through and through, it brings a lot of efficiencies to the whole supply chain and less waste generated.
Got it. And going back to John for a moment, you know, as an e-commerce business, how does ShipMonk address this and communicate this to customers?
Yeah, I mean, we're constantly looking at how it will be more efficient and also more sustainable in terms of the package and materials that we use, and also how we can reduce costs. So from looking at, you know, always having an eye to the market in terms of different materials that can be used to fill void more shipping packages, to looking at how can we create smaller packaging. We're actually looking at some technology right now that will enable us to really fit a box around a package and really reduce the amount of corrugate and fill that's needed to ship products. Those are some of the different ways. I mean, there's some waste involved anytime that you ship product to consumer in terms of the box and the damaged materials. Where we can, we always use either materials made out of recycled materials or at minimum materials that can be recycled. But I think there's a lot of money in the business in terms of creating more unique packaging materials because this is such a hot topic. Our R&D team and engineers are always looking at ways in which we can stay in the leading edge of that.
Dan, can you talk about, you read my mind, can you talk about that? How important is this for a consumer specifically, and how should businesses address this?
Well, our business is people, our assets are people. And, and so the way that we try to be more sustainable is to reduce our overall net carbon footprint. So travel, we reduce our travel. We did that initially, we did that with COVID initially, but I think it's here to stay in terms of the ability. I don't think we'll be traveling as much as we have in the past. That's because we can, we've proven that we can do the work remotely. There's still going to be a need for travel, but I think our overall net carbon footprint will be reduced as a result of COVID, and then we'll continue going forward. And I think what we're, the way we're trying to address this for the companies that we serve is we believe sustainability and achieving long-term sustainability is by through education. I don't think there's one silver bullet for any of this. At Accenture, what we've done internally, and we're also doing this for our clients, is creating a set of educational materials around sustainability, because sustainability is the responsibility of everybody. And so we call it our sustainability quotient. If we increase everybody's sustainability quotient, that means everybody's thinking in a sustainable way, everybody's acting in a sustainable way, and those ideas then get translated into the products and the services that we provide consumers. And so, and then ultimately, those consumers that buy these products in retail stores, et cetera, will tend to gravitate to those retailers that are acting and thinking in the same ways that the consumers are thinking about it, which is to be able to provide sustainable products and services going forward. So those are the businesses ultimately that will survive, the ones that act in a responsible way. And we believe all of it starts with education.
Got it. And that actually leads me to my next question. And for the next two questions, I'm going to arrange this as a lightning round. So I have a question, and I'm going to go to each panelist, and you have 30 seconds to give me your thoughts on this topic. And jumping off what you were talking about, so it'll be really difficult for businesses, retailers, to be successful moving forward without a future-ready workforce, right? Addressing these labor shortages that all of you touched upon. How can businesses build that future-ready workforce? What steps can they take? I want to start with John.
Sure. I think from an entry-level workforce perspective, it's about creating, it's obviously being competitive with wages, right? It's table stakes. But beyond that, it's also having an environment that would want people to not only want to be there in the entry-level positions, but also grow their career. So what I hear time and time again from the younger generation is that they want to understand what they have to do to move up to the next level. So I think what would enable that is a company that obviously provides a great workplace, fun environment, but also shows people what they need to do to move up, because people are very eager to see that pathway.
Got it. Thank you. Let's move on to Dan. What can businesses do to prep this future-ready workforce?
I think Accenture is, we focus on technology as well, and how technology enables businesses to grow and thrive. I think the merge of humans and technology together, and upskilling workers to be able to interact and leverage technology to their benefit will be the answer. And we'll continue to grow upon this until the worker is now leveraging technology in a way that gives them the time to focus on more valuable things.
Got it. Thank you. And Alvaro, your thoughts on this. What can businesses do to help build this future-ready workforce?
Yes. Well, first of all, I will echo what John then just said. I would just add that particularly this younger generation, millennials and Gen Zs, meaningfulness is something very important. So they want to be doing meaningful work, and just making sure that processes that are not meaningful are automated, and that we give them the tools and training to perform those meaningful tasks, it's paramount.
Got it. And my next question, we've spent the past 45 minutes talking about changes in consumer behavior, changes in retail during the pandemic. What do you think the retail store of the future looks like? What are you expecting in, let's say, 2025? And let's start with Alvaro this time.
I guess we'd be surprised by standing 2025 or even beyond and noticing that human interaction, authenticity are still at the core of the retail industry. And that's going to continue.
Got it. Dan, what do you think we'll be talking about when we discuss the consumer of the future in 2025? What are you expecting?
I think what we're going to see ultimately are three things. Number one, heavy personalization. You've got to personalize everything to the consumer's likes and dislikes. Make sure that you're personalizing everything. Number two, I think experiences. I think customers are going to want not just to go into a store and buy something, but to go into a store and feel good about buying something and have a good experience about going into the store or going online to buy that to buy it. And then number three, this notion of sustainability is not going away. Our planet needs us to be overall more sustainable, especially even the retail sector in particular. And we need to make sure consumers are going to want to buy from retailers that are focusing on sustainability and the betterment of the planet.
Thank you. And finally, John, what are your thoughts? What do you think we can expect by 2025 when we're talking about the consumer of the future?
I think as it relates to what they want to enjoy is from in terms of the retail store environment, I think it'd be less inventory, less actual buying, more experiences, more of a social gathering area where the people can connect with brands and touch and feel items. And then really by 2025, I think people will buy what they want and expect it in all different, be delivered in all different ways, whether to their homes or the storefront, for their maybe socialize during the weekend, or other ways, same day delivery. So high expectations for consumers interacting with brands in person through a social experience.
Great, thank you. And let's see, I think we just have a few questions from our audience. Someone had asked a question for John. They said that you mentioned custom packaging when you were speaking earlier. They're asking, are there any leading 3D printers for packaging?
In terms of 3D printers for Corian, not that I'm aware of, but we're that's 3D printing companies for more complicated packaging. But there is a lot of money being dumped into custom made corrugate that would minimize the need for fill. One company that comes to mind is a company called Pack Size that has got some pretty interesting technology. Now, I'll tell anyone that's a pretty big investment in terms of buying. We're talking about a 6, not 7-figure investment in terms of capital needed, but the great thing is that like any other industry or innovation, the first round is extremely expensive, the costs come down over time. So with all the money that's being dumped into it and the focus on sustainability, I expect in the next 5 years, there'll be a lot more options out there in terms of different opportunities.
Fantastic, thank you. There's a question for Dan, and hopefully I am reading this one correctly. The question is, Dan had mentioned insights before. With the shift to digital, how can retailers use insights so they can price based on value delivered and price higher for more value received by different segments?
Yeah, I think it's a fantastic question. We're definitely shifting to a value-based price system, not just in retail, but across the board in anything a consumer can purchase. Whether it's in the retail market or not. The idea here is to be able to gather as much information from the consumer as possible, which is why you're seeing customers constantly gathering information online, buying patterns, your historical information on the consumer itself, to be able to understand exactly what they value, how they value it, and how much they'll ultimately pay for it. I don't think we have a very good example yet of retail companies that are doing this very well yet. But I think the pressure is going to be to continue to look at ways to estimate what the value is for the customer and then price it accordingly.
Got it. Thank you. Let's see. I think we're wrapping up. Those were most of the questions that we had. So I just want to thank all of our panelists again for joining me here today. I really appreciate you taking the time to share your insights on this topic. We will be posting a recap of this conversation on Miami Inno shortly. Before then, don't hesitate to reach out if you have any questions. This goes to the panelists and everybody watching. You can always contact me at aportero@bizjournals.com. So once again, thank you for taking time out of your day to join us. I hope you have a great afternoon. And thanks again to Accenture and our founding partners, Ryder, Comcast Business, and OmniPublic.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Have a fantastic afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you.